And welcome to the Doris Davenport program with Doug Wyman. We are so excited to be back with you yet another weekend. And what a beautiful weekend this has turned out to be. One, not just because it is the Paschal weekend, we are right on the heels of Easter next weekend, winding down Lent. 40 days, it's been wonderful. I know over at Ascension we've been doing a carbon fast, and I must say I started out strong and then I started pewtering away, and each time I found myself tearing off a paper towel, I just had to say, you're not doing too well, sister. So anyway, maybe Doug has done better. He'll let us know. Hey, Doug.
Hey, Doug.
How are you?
I'm very, very well.
Are you now?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that.
A busy, busy week.
How, well, you know, you, your dance card is more full than most people I know.
That's what my caregiver said.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I have to say, Doug, you turned 89 years old, and that to me says when most people hear you talk about caregivers, they may assume that these caregivers are taking care of you, but they are not. They are taking care of your lovely wife, Barbara.
They are indeed.
And they're doing a wonderful job, too. Who's there tonight?
Tonight we have Bella.
Hey, Bella. Bella's usually tuning in, so yeah. We want to send out a special hello to
Bella. Bella's a special caregiver.
Yes, she is. Yeah. And of course to Barbara, we hope we can see that twinkle in your eye. And tonight, I am very, very pleased to welcome somebody that many in the community know who has just become such a good friend to the Doris Davenport Show, and that is the newly elected Village of Oak Park Board Trustee, Mr. Dino Andrews. Welcome to the Doris Davenport Show.
Thank you, Doris. Thank you, Doug. It's a pleasure to be here.
It is a pleasure to have you. And most of you know that Dino Andrews is the owner of Felony Franks, and which is an organization that you'll hear more about under a different name. We'll let him tell us a little bit about that later, because he is also the recent winner of the Big Idea, which is, as you know, the annual prize given by the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation, for the Big Idea in Oak Park. And I'm waving my feather duster. Okay. So he won the $50,000 grand prize for the Big Idea, and we'll let him tell us a little bit about that too. So, but first of all, Doug, before we get into anything, why don't you just start us off by giving us a synopsis of what we did last week?
Sure. Last week we had two guests from the Elementary School District 97, Holly Spurlock, the board member, and Amy Felton, the vice president of the board. There was a half-hour discussion on why the district has two referendums up for the vote on April 4th. Doris asked many questions that the voters wanted answers to, and these two women were very well prepared, and the voters were satisfied with the answers because, as we all know, both referendums passed, the first with 54% of the vote, and the second with 60% of the vote. Oak Parkers want good schools, and they will pay for it. The next guest was president of the Board of Trustees, who refers to be called Mayor, Anand Abu Dhaleb. He told us who he is, his strengths and his weaknesses, what he and the board have accomplished the past 4 years, and plans for the next four. Downtown, Madison Street, Roosevelt Road, North Avenue, Harrison Street, and how the newly formed Oak Park Development Corp is progressing. He touched on safety issues, transparency, the Albion Project, and diversity. We're going to have him back and question him on these new issues, particularly since he's got a new board coming. And now here's Doug.
Well, thank you, Doug, for that wonderful synopsis. So now we're going to talk about some of the, we'll have our table talk segment and talk about some of the issues that are in the news today. And most importantly, we're going to spend this next 20 minutes or so talking about some of our new elected officials, both on the Board of Trustees. We have a new clerk. We have D97. We have D200. We have the Library Board and whatever else we have going on. And then we'll ask Dino to tell us a little bit about this new organization that he's got going and what he's what his plans are for it. So Dino, you're guest hosting now, so you can't necessarily just wait for me to ask you something this time around.
Well, so I'm not shy, as you know.
Yes, I do know that, and I'm glad about that. So yeah, so what do you think about this election?
Well, I'm thrilled to have won the election.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. It's, you know, I wanted to do this 10 years ago, but I didn't feel that I was going to be in town enough. I was working in the corporate world back then. So local, you know, issues and politics have always been important to me, but I knew that when I did decide to run that I wanted to be able to fully commit to it, and now I'm at a time in my life where I certainly can. And, you know, I think that Dan and I ran a very solid campaign, you know, very issues-based, very positive. The only downside is that, you know, as I said on the show just a couple of weeks ago, every one of the candidates were such great people, wonderful public servants. Just no matter what would have happened, I would have felt good about the future of our village. Obviously, I'm happy that I had one of the seats, and I'm happy for Dan, I'm happy for Simone. And yeah, I really look forward to the new dynamic coming into the village board, and I think that, you know, we'll be able to have a significant impact on the future of our village.
You know, I'm going to let you guys run with some of this, but I must say at the outset that I've never been one to vote for diversity for diversity's sake, and I wouldn't have had to do that this time because we had, like you said, really great candidates all the way around. I must say that I can't let it go without saying that for all the talk we've done as a community this year about diversity, that this is the first time in a long time that the board lacks diversity, ethnic diversity.
Sure.
And we have gender diversity, but we have no ethnic diversity, and I find that quite striking.
We also don't have a lot of age diversity. You know, that most people on the board are in a tighter age demographic than in the past. And while I absolutely agree with that, and I know that it's very important to have ethnic diversity on the board, one thing that I'm proud about is my record on diversity and the work in the village that I do on diversity. It's a really big issue for me and my family, and so I feel good going into it knowing that while the racial makeup of the board has changed, that the focus on this as a village priority certainly will not.
Right, and I'm glad to hear that. And I have to say, that's why I said it, you know, the way I did. But I think we've got a number of people where the proof will be in the pudding this time around, right? We trust and we vote because we believe in people. We believe in the values that people say they have and that we believe we've seen them live. So
correct.
I'm excited about what's happening. What do you think, Doug?
Mm-hmm. Well, I've been involved in politics in the town for the last 50 years. And I have to say that, you know, at one time we had all seven at the table. And had we had all seven, it would have been you three plus the two on it, and then whoever after that for the trustees. And then also say that being involved with the VMA that long that we did fall asleep.
Would you repeat that, please?
The VMA fall asleep.
Facts, folks, facts.
Yeah.
Yes, the VMA did fall asleep.
Yeah.
So what can we expect to change with the VMA? Is there a future for the VMA, or is this a future?
There is definitely a future for the VMA, because the principles of the VMA have always been very good principles in what this town has really evolved into over the last 60 years. Because, you know, 60, 70 years ago, we had terrible politics in the town. And the Democrats and the Republicans, neither of them really were doing the job. And so it only took six people to come together to say, hey, we got to change this. And those six got six, and those six got six. And before long, we had about 200 of us saying, yeah, okay, we're gonna change it. And we did. And that's, I've got a letter to the editor saying exactly this. And we are alive, and we are going to resurrect.
I'd like to echo what you just said, and also, you know, the VMA, I think it's important to know, that both Dan and I did seek the endorsement of the VMA. So the validity of the VMA as an organization in town was important to me enough to seek the endorsement. And, you know, the only reason that I didn't go on the VMA ticket when invited is because I, you know, Dan and I were so closely aligned, and there was no VMA ticket that included both Dan and myself, and that was the only, really the only reason why. And so I think had there been a ticket with Dan and I on the VMA slates, I think that we would have still put in the energy and the amount of work and the dedication and won it, and the headlines could have been a lot different for the VMA. So, and I also don't blame them for picking the slate that they did, because, you know, again, Glenn and Peter are fantastic people. So I think that the headlines went our way, but I don't think that the VMA will go away by any means.
And, absolutely not.
And I really look forward to see what they, you know, do in the next go around. We've got just, you know, a year and a half before the next cycle starts, so. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yep, we do. Absolutely.
And so what other races do we have? Well, let's see. First, let's talk about the people who won. We have your running mate, Dan Maroney, who mm-hmm. I understand is out of the country.
Yes, everybody has fled the country.
Yeah, I know.
Simone's out of the country, and Dan is out of the country, so I'm here holding down the fort during our elected or pre-election or pre-swearing-in time period, so that's exciting. And and our other running mate, Vicky, won the clerk position by mm-hmm. a pretty significant amount, and so we're really proud of Vicky, and
yes.
Obviously the work that she's done in town for years and years, you know, really helped her, and I think that she'll make a fantastic clerk, and I really look
yeah.
forward to seeing that office being reinvigorated, and you know, hopefully we can start to put some of the responsibility back into that office that has been taken from it in recent years. And I know that the three new trustees going in all feel the same way about that office, so I look forward to what's going to happen there as well.
Now, you know, since you're here, Dino, you know we have to pick your brain a little bit.
Sure.
So who makes that decision? I mean, what the decision to move things, because we heard a lot about that. We asked, when we had the clerk's debate, we asked questions about it. We had so much to talk to the mayor about that we actually didn't have a chance to bring up any of that kind of stuff, but... So who makes the decision? Was it a board decision to remove things? And was that the last administration, this administration? And who makes the decision to add or replace?
I'm going to be perfectly honest, and this is something
sure.
that I've always vowed to do as a politician. I have no idea how that happened. And I
wow,
don't think that
that's
it,
a breath of fresh air.
Right? It wasn't, it was a gradual process. You know,
mm-hmm.
it didn't all happen at once. And I think that there are some things that logically probably moved out of the clerk's office.
Sure.
Like stickers for cars that went into the parking department. There are things that logically move in and out of somebody's purview.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but the clerk is an important role because it's the only elected person in Village Hall
mm-hmm.
that cannot be hired or fired by the village manager. And so it's always been a significant office in the village, and it's been of a higher visibility in the past. And I think that the village clerk, it's kind of like the chief welcoming or the chief networking officer of the village, and it's
mm-hmm.
sort of the person who ties everything together at Village Hall. So again, the logical things that don't belong in that office, I absolutely endorse, and other things that that office should do. But I think that it will be up to Vicky to show her leadership and advocate for the things that she would like to see that office take on. And I think me as a board member going in, we have to look at what she wants to do with the office, and we need to make a decision with the village manager and kind of decide, you know, where does that office go in the future.
And often what happens is people have an opinion about what might have been added or subtracted until they get in there, and everybody starts talking, and before you know it, everybody realizes, well, maybe this was a good decision after all.
Absolutely.
So you can't just assume that just because somebody says it shouldn't be this way, that it shouldn't be that way.
Absolutely. There's a right way to do things, there's a wrong way to do things, and there's that whole spectrum in between right and wrong. And, you know, without looking back, just looking into the future, I really think that the clerk ought to put together an idea or a vision for that office and advocate for that vision and try to build a coalition around that vision and see if there's enough support for it on the board and in Village Hall, then that vision will, you know, be fulfilled. If there's not, then we need to work on the vision a little bit more. So it's just hard to say, but we'll see what happens. And Vicky's super qualified to do the job, and I think she'll do really, really good at it.
Yeah.
So what about some of these other races? It was definitely very interesting. What do you want to talk about next?
Yes. Let's take a look at the District 97.
That was very interesting.
Wasn't it?
Yes.
Yes. Ray Meyer got the top vote.
That's not a surprise. He's right. Very well known in town for his work.
Roy and then Murray and Leibel.
I think we've got three fantastic candidates that were elected. I met with Kisa Broy, and man, breath of fresh air. Super smart, very able, great perspective on diversity and equity. I think, when you look at the election as a whole across the board, I really think that this was the equity cycle. Because when you look at the people who were elected as trustees, a mainstay of our message was equity. Same in District 97, everybody's talking equity, and I'm really hoping that this next 10-year period can see a substantial change in the equitable use of resources in our village. Mm-hmm. So what are your thoughts on that?
Actually, what you just said, I think, is right on. And along with that, there's always been talk, election after election, that all of the boards need to get together more and look at a lot of things. First of all, the total mission in the village, the total mission in education, and how all those things come together. And also how we can use facilities from one that could be used for others. And that whole concept of cutting the costs by looking at the places that are naturally places to cut the costs.
Exactly.
So has there been some discussion going on that you know about along those lines with the folks who are running?
Nothing officially, but I've met with almost all of the candidates at some point on the campaign trail, and most people are saying the same thing about working together at a more accelerated rate. In the business world, it's called a synergy or an economy of scale. And that's something that I have a lot of experience with coming from my corporate background. And it's time. When you look at the referenda and how overwhelmingly they passed, it shows how much the village values education. And I was one of the only trustee candidates that actually came out and told people how I was feeling and how I was gonna vote on it. And it means that we value it. It doesn't mean that everybody loves higher taxes, right? So they're mutually exclusive arguments. And so I think if we're going to continue to value education and we're going to continue to value all the wonderful things that make Oak Park what it does, we need to prioritize those things, and then we need to work very diligently together to make sure that our expenses are in check, and mm-hmm. so that we're being the most diligent we can with taxpayer funding. And, mm-hmm. and that way, if we ever do have to go back for a referendum or a referenda, that we've really done everything we could to make sure that we didn't have to go there, or it's as small as it needs to be.
Right. And we did hear last week a lot about how the district is trying to keep costs down. And when I first moved here, there were 66,000 people in Oak Park, and now we have 52,000 and something. Which means we had a lot, and of course on the south side, where I live, the average family, I came here from Cincinnati and bragged about my nine children, and they said, oh, good start. next guy had 11, next guy had 12, it just went on and on. However, what has happened, interesting over that time, the block that we're on now, when we moved into, we're in our third Oak Park home, when we moved into that block, there were only 6 children on that block. Now there are 53.
Wow, that's incredible.
It is, absolutely. And so we have 1,500 more kids now than we had some time ago. And obviously that's gonna need more teachers, it's gonna need more of everything.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And so that, I think, got through to the, and I heard from many people who heard the two women that were on our show last week said, mm-hmm. wow, that really put it into perspective for me. And I understand that a lot of folks were saying they were waiting until the last minute and then asked the Holy Spirit to come down upon them when they came in. What do we do here?
Nice.
What do we do here? Right. So It was interesting, really interesting to see how that happened.
Doug, I'd like you to share your perspective. You and I had a conversation about a week before the election. We talked about it a few months ago, and I think you and I do a pretty good job of staying clear of each other's opinion on certain things so that we can stay neutral and allow each other our own space for what we believe politically.
Mm-hmm.
And you actually evolved on that issue somewhat. And I like the last thing that I found it very interesting and wondered how many people, and particularly of your age category, felt the way that you did about paying it forward based on the scripture of to whom much is given, much is expected.
Yes, right, yeah. And I have to say, I talked to a lot of seniors. In fact, one of them said to me, how are you going to vote? I said, you know, I'm not sure. I really am not sure. I know I would vote for the second one, the one that, you know, let's take care of it, let's take care of the house. And the first one, I really have to think about that, how that's going to affect particularly the senior citizens, you know, somewhere between 700 to whatever, depending on their taxes. And this woman said to me, you know, I am having that same struggle. And I'm for the schools, and when my children were young, the older folks voted to help my kids, and so my inclination is to vote for it. And I said, well, you know, that really is good to hear from someone who's not quite my age, but sort of up there. But watching that evolve and one handily, you know, as opposed to the high school where they lost by only 18 votes. But there you had a totally different situation, you know, where they were looking at which one of the three or four different things that they would be taking.
The other thing with the high school too is that it wasn't necessarily about education. And I think that played a big part in it. You know, we're talking about, there was some talk about education and improving some of the classrooms around the pools and stuff. But I think in the end, when people look at the two, they look at the District 97 referenda and they think education and our kids. And when they looked at the pool referendum, it looked more like sports and swim teams and swim classes, which people don't value as much as education in this town. And I think that played a big part in it too.
Well, and also, and it was interesting, it ended up being, hey, yeah, we need a new swimming pool. But we really have to, there are other alternatives that would be much less expensive to look at. And I certainly hope that the new board will be looking at that as well.
Certainly.
Because my kids, I had three swimmers, and I thought, well, yeah, we'd like to have a pool, but we don't need an Olympic-sized swimming pool. We can do it with a smaller one. And there's a lot of different ways to cut the costs. So that whole concept of, let's do it, and let's do it right, and make sure that we help the families, the children in this village to be able to live the kind of life that, you know, we expect them to, is still there, and we can still do that. And that's why I'm very interested in you three and the message that you'll bring to the board in relation to the difference between cost and price, and that whole issue of how do we do the right things right and still keep it within a reasonable budget.
Right. Yeah. That's going to be the thing, and that was the other argument that I used too. Like right now wasn't the time to fight the cost of the referenda. You know, those costs have been accruing over the last 10 years. And so this is why it's really important to have people on boards who have that long-term view, so that like right now starts the fight to minimize the next referendum,
mm-hmm.
right? Or completely eradicate it or eliminate it. And it would be really hard to be where we're at now and then say no and have drastic things happen to the schools and then try to move forward. So I'm always about fighting the next fight and not necessarily, you know, being an activist against what has happened over the last decade,
mm-hmm.
In terms of cost overruns, or not overruns, but cost rise over mm-hmm. the last 10 years. So
yep.
it's just about looking forward versus looking backwards. And,
mm-hmm.
and I think that each of these boards got the right people who are really going to be looking at these things moving forward and trying to do absolutely everything that they can to minimize that trajectory of tax levy increases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, right. Right, and then we also have District 200, where Barron, Kofsky, Isley, and Moore were elected. Did you have an opportunity to spend any time with any of those folks?
A little bit. I went to a couple of the forums or debates and saw what everybody had to say there. Haven't spent much time with Jackie, but I found her to be very intelligent and able at the forums, and so that didn't surprise me at all, and I believe that she won biggest margin.
Yes, I was very excited about her, I have to say. I started pushing for her a lot on Facebook, yeah.
Well, I just loved in the debates how forthcoming she was, mm-hmm. and how, you know, when she was asked a question, she answered it, and she answered it with conviction, and I like to vote for people, not necessarily that I agree or disagree with them on every policy issue, but I like to vote for people who convince me that I'm in good hands, whether I agree or not. And I feel like she's, you know, demonstrated her leadership at those debates that I was at and said the right things, and I just have a lot of faith in her. So that's really cool. Mm-hmm. Kofsky and Isley, yeah, both great guys, presented very well in the debates. You know, and Matt Barron does not surprise me at all. He's president of the library board. He's very well known in town. He's, you know, pretty much loved and adored almost everywhere he goes. So I think it was a toss up between him and Weissglass. And, mm-hmm. and you know, it's hard when you have so many good people. Somebody has to win and somebody has to lose. But I don't know if to say much deeper than that. I think it just came down to the popularity of Matt and what he's done with the library board, mm-hmm. and I certainly think that helped to elevate him into that, you know, into winning the seat.
Right, and you know, it has to be said that Oak Park High School, as an education institution, has always been a great school, and over the years, all the folks that have spent their time, given of their time, zero money involved in it, have all in some way or another affected that school being a great school, because each person came in, you know, with their own vision on this and where they would like to go with it. And you're right, it is sad that Loma has to lose. And along those lines, I can't let this conversation go that I have to shout out to Glenn Brewer and also Peter Barber, and just let you guys know that I spent a lot of time with those guys. And I was so taken by who they are as individuals and what they bring. And Glenn, for 8 years, was the guy that really did his homework. He was the one that people would say, well, you know, what do we do about this? And then he studied the thing. And when people had questions, he's the one that they went to.
Yeah.
And Glenn, on the other hand, was the one that was out there listening to the people. I'd work with Glenn in the field, and I'd say, wow. Because he would go in and say, well, you know, Peter, well, here's who I am, but I'm more interested in finding out what your issues. And he would listen to these, and he would get these people involved. And Oak Parkers are not too shy. Let you know.
Not at all.
What's on their mind, as you found out, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So, guys, I want to really thank you for your services, and please hang in there with us in this town.
Yeah, I, you know, on election night, Glenn called me and had some very nice things to say, and I really appreciated that, and I called him back. And I also reached out to him on Facebook because I believe in continuity of concept, and I reached out to him, and I will get together with him before I'm sworn in, and I told him that my intent is to learn from him, draw from his wisdom, and also find out what some of the goals that he had for his next term, so that I can in some way work with him and try to carry on some of the initiatives that are important to him, because mm-hmm. he's been a fantastic public servant, and I've got all the respect in the world for Glenn and Peter for that matter. And I really want to make sure that, you know, we're not just coming in as a new board and everything is new. You know, I want to make sure that there's some continuity, that there's a continuation of that collective ethic that's been established with them on the board. And, you know, make changes where needed, but not drastic changes and not drastic changes immediately. Mm-hmm. And so hopefully, well, we've already talked online that we'll get together. And I really look forward to that, because I mm-hmm. think that I couldn't have a smarter guy to draw from in the weeks ahead of my swearing in.
Well, I'm happy to hear you say that, because that's both of those guys have a lot to offer along those lines. And I'm also really happy that Oak Park took President Obama's lead when he says, hey, I'm going to run for your library board.
Right, exactly.
What, eight running here, nine running there, seven running here, six running there. Way to go, President.
That's right. Way to go, President Obama. And this is a good time to cut in, because you guys are having too much fun. So several things I'd like to do now. You know, most, and I think this is the last week I'm going to do this. I keep saving a lot of things till the 6:30, half an hour, because I know that's when people are used to tuning in. But we have a new start time now, and our new start time is 6 o'clock. So 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. We're doing our best to market this and get the new time frame out there. We're in a two-hour format now. We're real excited about that and hope that we have the support from the community. And we're very pleased that our friends from greatlocalshops.com, www.greatlocalshops.com, are in the studio with us to give you some additional options to hear and view the program. So yes, of course, you can go to 1490 AM on your radio dial. You can live stream on www.radiowpna.com for audio. You can go to Doris Davenport on Facebook Live. Dino is teaching me all the technology. He says, I must know. Everybody wave to your Facebook fans. Hello. Are we actually up?
We're live.
Okay. Well, hello out there. And now if you want audio and video in living color in absolute high definition provided by the greatlocalshops.com, John Roberts and Ed Pitts, you can head on over to www.greatlocalshops.com, and there you can view us live. And the program will also be posted there in our video archive. And I have to tell you, when you go there, I ask you to please, it's like going into a candy store. So I ask you to just kind of ignore the other candy for tonight. You can always go back, but what you'll find when you get over to www.greatlocalshops.com is that you're actually on an online shopping mall. It's not the place where you want to shop to buy goods and services. It's the place to go to find out where to go to buy goods and services here in our local community. They're actually a national organization. They are setting up shop in Washington, D.C., New Orleans, and New York as well. But we are focusing here on the Oak Park area. And we like to bring you many of the business leaders, the entrepreneurs, nonprofit organizations. If you want to find out more about Dino Andrews, who is our guest host tonight and the owner of Felony Franks, you can head on over to www.greatlocalshops.com, and you will find him there as well with some of our other favorites. And I know it's hard to say favorites, right, because we love everybody, but we do have a couple of favorites. One of them is Jason and Rebecca over at the book table. You can find them there. Also, Serena Tea, which is a wonderful tea shop here locally. But you'll just find so many things for your viewing pleasure and for your knowledge. And please support our local communities. This is really it's our local economic development engine that keeps our community thriving. So we want to make sure that we give them the support that they deserve. And on that note, we are going to take a quick break. And on the other side of the break, we're going to be welcoming the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation CEO and President, Kristen Carlson-Bogan. And she has a couple of special guests that she's going to introduce to us. I tell you, I always say they have a dance card that is always events that are sold out that you don't want to miss. And there are things that are going on over there that you want to make sure you put on your calendar, and this is one of them. We will be right back. And welcome back to the Doris Davenport Show with Doug Wyman. We have been having a bit of a little party here. Carla, who you'll meet in a few minutes, looked up and said, "You guys didn't tell me this was a dance show." But, you know, we can't help but put our throwback songs on, and there's certain people, certain guests, when they come in, I kind of know their vibe, and one of those people is none other than Jim Madigan. And everybody doesn't necessarily know that about Jim, that Jim likes to dance. So when I see Jim, and we are in the business setting, I like to bring that vibe out in him. And that was fun. And then, of course, Doug, my co-host, Doug Wyman, could not stand the fact that Jim and I were cutting a rug on Facebook Live, and Doug had to get up and join in. Not only did Doug get up and join in with his fancy footwork, but he took me for a spin, and I've got a bit of a flush on. Oh. Stop smiling, Doug.
That's why Barbara dated me. Give her a flush.
Yeah. Well, you know, I always say, I don't think that many people realize, Doug, that you and Barbara, how many years ago are we talking? 50? No joke.
60? Yeah.
You just turned 89.
Yeah, probably 70.
70 years ago, yeah. You guys were the king and the queen of the jitterbug scene. Mm-hmm. And I have to
over
tell you.
Over the head and underneath. Yes,
yeah. And if you guys saw some of his moves, you would understand why that is absolutely so. Well, listen, we're not going to waste any time as I take care of this little flush that I've got over here. Somebody should be taking that cue to bring some cold water for a young lady. But that's okay. I'll survive. So listen, we are so excited. First of all, I want to let everybody know that if you tuned in to 1490 AM on your radio dial, you'll be listening to us talk to you right now. You can also listen to us with the audio live stream at www.radiowpna.com.
Say it again.
www.radiowpna.com. But even better than that for tonight, and this is a treat because we don't always have this option for you, but for your video and audio pleasure, if you head over right now to www.greatlocalshops.com, you can visit us right here in the studio. We might even do another dance for you. And you'll be able to see the show live and hear it live as well. We're also live streaming on Facebook under Doris Davenport. So join us. We have a lot of options for you. We just had a wonderful segment led by our guest co-host, who is the newly elected Village Board of Trustee member, Dino Andrews. He is also the owner of Felony Franks, and he is the recent winner of the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation Big Idea, which was a grand total of $50,000. So congratulations twice to you.
Thank you so much.
And now we are immediately going to move into our next segment, where we're going to be talking about an event that's coming up. And you know, I'm always telling you about the events that are taking place from the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation. And this time, we talked about this last year, but they teamed up with one of their favorite partners, the Oak Park Public Library. And we have some people in the studio today who are going to tell us about this absolutely fantastic event. So first of all, Doug, I think that you might be able to, here, give that to Dino. So first I want to introduce someone who is the head of the Oak Park Public Library. And I actually know there's somebody else who is the actual head, but since they've never been here, you're the head. The library's assistant director for administrative services, James Madigan. He actually celebrated 20 years of outstanding service to the library and the community last year. And a resolution was approved by the Board of Library Trustees to recognize him for his wonderful commitment, his talents, and his leadership. But he launched into his professional library leadership in 1994 as the Coordinator of Administrative and Community Services. And in the last two decades, he's provided vital vision, consistent support, and significant contributions in the critical roles of Assistant Director for Management Services, Assistant Director for Administration, Assistant Director for Administration and Finance, and currently as the Assistant Director for Administrative Services. He earned his Master's in Library Science, his continued management of the library's tuition reimbursement program, and his commitment to mentoring current library school students and staff. And there are many people who will attest to the good that that has done. James Madigan demonstrates his investment in the development of future libraries. And he continues to show his steadfastness, his essential leadership roles in the renovation process of the Mays Branch Library and the planning and construction of the current award-winning Main Library, which is, you know, it's a spectacle. You have to go and see it. It's wonderful. We have so, I love the big idea box there, which we kind of took over last year during a day in our village. But he's recognized for his broad community connections and his appreciation for and respect of literally all types of people. And it's just enhanced the library's reputation as a community gathering place. And we just so appreciate that. His professional commitment is obvious to progressive issues like racial justice and the library industry's formal response to the U.S. Patriot Act when that was big and in the news, and of course to the Welcoming Village Ordinance. But it really just represents the lifeblood of social responsibility in librarianship, and people don't really realize the importance that the library pays. I want to give a special kudos to Jim Madigan because he was invited to a screening that I hosted at the Austin Library on behalf of the One Earth Film Festival. And it was really a fantastic event. It was just totally over crowded in every way.
It was an incredible community event.
Yeah.
And it was just like earlier tonight. Mm-hmm. It was a big community party.
Right, wasn't it? Wasn't
yeah.
it? It was really great. We've screened the film Growing Cities, and it was a film about urban agriculture, and we'll actually talk a little bit about urban agriculture in our next segment. But this particular screening, we had so many people there, and the community partners that played a role in it just did, they really did so much. The Westside Health Authority, Hope Community, Hope Christian Church, St. Martin de Porres, I can't even begin to name them all. But what I want to give you kudos for, Jim Madigan, is for stepping up and agreeing to have discussions with the head of the Austin Library there, Joanne Willis, to look at what we can do together. I've been really trying to push for a new Friends of the Library organization, which we don't have right now. Well, I shouldn't say we don't have it, because Dr. Romano stepped up to replace their their PA system. But anyway, welcome to the Doris Davenport Show. Welcome back to the Doris Davenport Show, and thank you for that fantastic dance. Dina, why don't you introduce our next guest, who will be joining Jim in this conversation.
Our next guest is Carla Taylor. I've been reading this very impressive bio that I want to hear more about this Barbie dream house that you have here. It looks like you've done absolutely everything in the world in terms of the real estate business, and it's very impressive, and also an interior designer in your past. So I read here that you fell in love with the real estate industry when you bought your first home, and you love the process and the paperwork and the stress, which is not something that everybody loves to deal with. You got your real estate license not because you wanted to sell homes for a living, but because you were looking for the information and being a flipper. So it's very exciting, and we look a lot forward to hearing more about that and also more about your past.
Thank you. It's good to be here. Awesome. So now you guys are here to talk to us about this fantastic event that's coming up. And this event is called the Volunteer Meet and Match. Is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah. So tell us, what is this year's event?
Well, this year's event is the second annual, and it was really initiated by the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation with a number of partners, including the YMCA, Housing Forward, 10,000 Villages, RSVP, which is a volunteer program at Triton College, and the Oak Park Public Library. And this takes place at the library, and it is going to be taking place on April 26th between 4 p.m. and 8 p.m. And I just have to say that there were literally hundreds of people who came last year's event. And the only problem that we really had was that there were so many people. And that was, that's a good problem to have, typically. And so we've addressed that this year in our planning. We're going to be continuing to use the Veterans Room where it took place last year, but we're also going to be in the community room down on the first floor.
Ah, wow. So that's going to be pretty awesome, huh?
We expect it will be even more fun than last year.
Well, I have to tell you that I can attest to it being more fun than last year, because this year we're going to be there with our cameras. We are going to be there, the Doris Davenport Show, and we'll also be there with our partners, GreatLocalShops.com, Ed Pitts and John Roberts, who of course is the owner of Pert's Office Supply. So we're real excited, because what we're going to do is to help to highlight many of the organizations that are there. And we're going to interview them on the floor and in the different spaces. We'll have something set up where they can come and we can feature them.
Well, I love pop-up programming, and I think of this as that. And I remember what a great time it was last year when you were at Day in Our Village, which is coming up, and being able to be inside interviewing all sorts of people.
That's right, that's right. We had a great time over there, I have to tell you. That was not something that we did not, we didn't let any grass grow under our feet for that one. So listen, this year's event that's taking place on April 26th, it's culminating with the National Volunteer Week, right?
Yes.
And the National Volunteer Week, so everyone knows, is April 23rd through the 29th. And all over the country, volunteers are going to be recognized for their commitment of service. And this is when people really get engaged in performing all kinds of service projects. And in Oak Park and River Forest, this is the event that you guys do every year. You have a coordinator. Who's working with the West Cook YMCA. Now, isn't the West Cook YMCA a lead sponsor?
Yes, they are.
This year, right?
Yes.
And who are some of the other sponsors for the program? You've got Housing Forward.
Housing Forward, 10,000 Villages, the Symphony of Oak Park, Root Forest, RSVP of West Suburban and Southern DuPage Counties.
Right, that's right. And these are wonderful organizations. And these are organizations that will help develop the event. And they, what they'll do is match individual needs, match individual interests and skills with the nonprofit organization that needs their help, right? So how many nonprofits are there registered?
45.
Wow, that's a lot. And each one of these organizations are looking for volunteers?
Yes.
Yeah? And they'll be volunteering in just Oak Park and River Forest?
I believe overwhelmingly in those.
And we know that some of them are going to be at Forest Park and Elmwood Park, Maywood, Berwyn, Cicero. So they're going to be in all of these different areas. So now, tell us, how does the volunteer meet and match work?
Well, to start off, the not-for-profits will have tables at the library, and they'll have information about what their organization provides and the skill requirements that they're looking for. And potential volunteers can go, they can meet, And then if they're interested, sign up in order to get involved in forwarding the causes that they really care about. Many people have already registered, and some of the volunteers are trying to match up and say, well, these are the these are the organizations you might want to meet with that day. There'll be a table downstairs so that we'll welcome people in. We really tried to learn from last year. And last year, although it was very successful, there was a little bit of chaos also. And we're trying to eliminate the chaos and make people more comfortable.
Why was there chaos?
Because it was so popular. It was more popular than we could have imagined.
It was very, as a volunteer who actually went to the event last year, I was very impressed with the amount of people that were there to help, to help the community out by volunteering.
That's amazing.
Yes, there was chaos, but it was impressive chaos.
It was good chaos. It was good chaos.
Incredibly positive energy. And that was really the main thing that was going on.
And we visitors that were came in, we didn't know about chaos.
Good.
Yeah. We just said, wow, that was really great.
It was great.
So now, what's nice is that when people go around to the different exhibits, what they're going to do is have a conversation with the representative that's there representing that particular organization. And so they'll have a discussion. And you know, I'm all about the story. So whatever transpires in that story experience between the two really is going to depend on the organization. So it'll be based on the description of the mission, what their impact is as a nonprofit, what kind of volunteer job descriptions they're looking for. Some of them may even have the job descriptions for volunteers right there at the exhibit. So this is a real meet, mix and match. They want to make sure, and I know I always say mix and match, but it's meet and match.
Meet.
So they'll be able to actually give you the necessary skills and qualifications that they're looking for. And we know that these organizations here in Oak Park and River Forest, they're seeking a wide range of volunteers. When you talk about 40 organizations that are going to be discussing their mission, the work, their needs, there's a potential for almost 300 volunteers to end up taking advantage of this. Now, Carla, let me ask you, what were some of the benefits that nonprofits stated last year?
That it was a well-run, one-stop shop for volunteerism, so people didn't have to go to each different organization. They could just go to one spot and find all of the organizations who were looking for volunteers. That the volunteers were getting the word out about their agency. It was a very well-run, organized event. There was a lot of networking going on. New volunteers that were not familiar with any of the organizations, they could learn about them at the event. They loved coming to the library for the venue, and then very diverse audience and a lot of different opportunities.
And what were some of the results, Jim, from last year?
Well, some of the results were that organizations found that they had an opportunity to meet with very many people. And the numbers showed that each organization that was there spoke to an average of 35 people. And these are people they may not have had an opportunity to meet otherwise. They had a chance to tell their story. And even if you don't make a match, you still get to tell your story and popularize your organization.
Right.
There's so many organizations doing really good work that need more publicity and they need more people knowing about what they do. This event really pushes that out there for the whole public to know about.
That's awesome.
And then we know that if you have a good experience, and I think most people who came to this had a really good experience, they tell other people about the stories that they listened to and that they learned. So this spreads throughout the community. And I think that was the wonderful thing about last year. And then, of course, there were opportunities where people actually got involved with an organization. Like Carla.
That's right, because Carla, you were actually recruited from an organization that participated last year, isn't that right?
I was.
Tell us about it.
Yes.
That was good, Jim.
Good lead in, right?
Oh, wait, did I mention we had two guest hosts?
All about the segue.
So I've done a lot of volunteering throughout my career. I'm a single parent, so for the last 7 or so years, I've not done a whole lot in the community, but because I'm a single parent, but my son is 14 now, so I can kind of get out there. Anyway, so I wanted to do something, I wanted to volunteer, and when I saw the ad in the newspaper, I thought, oh, that would be a great event for me to go to. So I registered online, and I was able to see what organizations were there, and they also had them listed what they were looking for in their volunteers. So 10,000 Villages was looking for somebody with marketing and events background, mm-hmm. Of which I have that. So I specifically went to the event to speak to 10,000 Villages. So when I got there, they were like the first table I saw, and I headed over. And it was a great connection, and it's kind of just how it happened. A couple of weeks later, they had an orientation for everybody who came to the event, and so we got a chance to tour the store and find out a little bit more about it.
Mm-hmm. I've got a couple of questions. This is Dino. This sounds like such a giant thing to put together. Who's involved in putting this together, and who are your community partners to be able to succeed at something like this?
Well, earlier Carla talked about the various organizations that are like sponsoring organizations, but there's an organizing committee that has been putting this together, and that includes Ruth Renko with the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation, and it includes individuals from the YMCA, Housing Forward, 10,000 Villages, RSVP at Triton, and from the Oak Park Public Library.
And what kind of, how long does it take to put something like this together? I've run events in my career over years and years. This seems really difficult and challenging. Can you tell us a little bit about what that process is like?
Well, first of all, what I would say is that because this is the second annual, there was a coming together in order to evaluate last year's shortly after the event took place. And there was so much great energy that that was generated by that event that people immediately committed to doing this again. And so that means that we really planned this to some extent for an entire year. Although more of the planning took place closer to the event, but it really was a year-long process.
That's fantastic. And is there any sort of measurement about the efficacy of this? I mean, when you get people together to volunteer, I mean, that only increases community engagement, but it also gives organizations a big impact on their bottom line, having people volunteer time that would otherwise take consultants and employees to do. So is there any, does the organization think about what the overall impact of this event is?
Well, I think that, there's two different ways at least to measure things. One is by the stories that people tell, and the other is by the numbers. And we know that we have more not-for-profits signed up this year, 45 versus 40. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be looking at the numbers. We know that organizations reported that it was very valuable to them to participate. And in that four-hour period, they met more people than some of them had met in 2 months previously. And that was a good thing.
Wow. Now, I also know that River Forest Township has declared April 26th Volunteer Day. And we're hoping that Oak Park Village will do the same at the next board meeting. And maybe since we have a newly elected village board trustee sitting at the table, he can influence some of his future comrades. We know you're not.
I hope so. May 1st, I get sworn in. So
right.
Before then, I'm just lobbying like you are.
That's right. One of the things we learned from Kristen is the national study that was done about volunteerism around the country. We discovered that there's more volunteering that takes place in Oak Park than almost anywhere else. And certainly, the numbers are hugely different from how much we volunteer here in Oak Park than even our neighbors in Chicago. And some people might find that hard to believe, but it doesn't make it any less true. But Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation provides training aimed at enhancing volunteer engagement through the nonprofit capacity building program called Impact Excellence. So those of you who are really interested in volunteering more, please get in touch with the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation. And I don't think we've mentioned the website yet. It's www.oprfcf.org. And ask about that Impact Excellence program. But make sure that you put April 26th on your calendar. What are the hours again?
From 4 until 8 p.m.
4 until 8 p.m., and it's going to take place at the Oak Park Public Library. It is going to be the place to be. And not only that, OPRFCF surveyed last year participants of different nonprofits for feedback on the event and other needs for engaging volunteers, and they had a session on how to recruit and retain great volunteers. So this is not just the type of an event where we ask organizations to come and then ask people who are interested to come and volunteer. There's some science behind how this is actually put together. And so we would love for you to take it and know that we take your time, the OPRFCF and the Oak Park Public Library really take your time very seriously. And they've done a lot of homework to put this together and make it just as valuable for you as we know once you put your time it will be for the organizations that you meet and match up with. So I'd like to ask you, Carla, what motivated you to pick 10,000 Villages?
Have you been to their store?
I was in there just the other day to put your poster up.
I love the store. I love the merchandise in the store. I love the fact that it is fair trade and it helps artisans from developing countries to earn a living.
Mm-hmm.
The merchandise is handmade, mm-hmm. or it's recycled.
And is there a personal benefit to you? Do you feel a personal benefit since you actually started working there?
Personal benefit?
Yeah.
Connecting with the women,
uh-huh.
that work in the store, connecting with the different committees that they have. I've been involved with recruitment,
mm-hmm.
so we have volunteer meetings every month where, you know, we get to network with each other and play games and have fun, and we get a discount at the store.
That's actually pretty nice because when you talk about fair trade, it's usually fair trade among third world countries, and one of the big things in these third world countries is networking among women.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very interesting that is one of the things that's highlighted for you as a personal benefit.
Right.
I think that's pretty fantastic. Do you have a favorite memory so far?
A favorite memory?
Yeah.
Other than when I got hit in the head with the...
In the head with the wall.
At least you remember it.
I was going to say.
With an easel.
With an easel.
I was doing a presentation on volunteerism and recruitment, and we were putting up the easel when I got hit in the head.
Oh, my goodness.
But since I've been volunteering there, I started out with marketing. And then there was a need for recruitment to get additional volunteers working in the store. And the marketing and recruitment kind of goes hand in hand
Sure.
together. So I got involved with recruitment.
then I was instrumental in putting together 10,000 Villages with the One Earth Film Festival.
Mm-hmm.
And the most recent accomplishment is that I am a board member and will be their treasurer.
Oh, wonderful. Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. And Jim, how does your role as host, because that's a really, really big role, how does your role as host for the Volunteer Meet and Match event fit with your overall strategic goal for the library?
Well, that's a great question, of course. And the Oak Park Public Library has three overarching strategic goals: engagement, learning, and stewardship.
Mm-hmm.
And we believe that this is absolute direct engagement with the community in order to both partner with other organizations,
mm-hmm.
but also to invite community members who wish to volunteer into our library. And so that, you know, that addresses the engagement, but the stewardship is also very important. And volunteers, you know, really as Dino mentioned, volunteers make a great contribution to organizations and ended up saving us money,
mm-hmm.
and enabling us to do more with limited resources.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So listen, we want to remind everybody who the people are that are involved in this organization. So first of all, it's being sponsored by the Oak Park River Forest Community Foundation, and Kristen Carlson Bogan is the president and CEO of the foundation. The OPRFCF is the coordinator for the event. They're working with the organizing committee, which consists of some of our really, really wonderful nonprofits in town. The West Cook YMCA is the lead sponsor. They're partnered up with Housing Forward, Symphony of Oak Park and River Forest, 10,000 Villages, and Retired and Senior Volunteer Program of Triton College. We have Jim Madigan, who is here with us, Assistant Director of the Oak Park Public Library, who is the host for the event. And the library will also be recruiting volunteers for the event. I think you guys better put some extra forms out, because you guys have some pretty great events coming up yourselves, which we'll have to have you back on to talk about. And Carla Taylor, who is a volunteer recruited from last year's event, is here representing one of the other partners on the organizing committee, and that is 10,000 Villages of Oak Park. We would like to thank all of you for being here. And what is the one thing you want to remind people about for this upcoming event? Both of you, please. Your elevator pitch.
Make sure you go with a purpose. You know what you want to do. You know what you're passionate about. I think that's always helpful, because then that way you show up instead of just going there and signing up and then never getting involved. If you're passionate about something, you are going to show up and actually volunteer.
All right, Jim?
The thing I would stress to people is that although the volunteer is giving, the volunteer gets a great deal as well. And they get to feel like they're contributing to the community. They get camaraderie from other volunteers and staff at the organization that they mm-hmm. are linked up with.
Great. Well, we want to thank you all for coming in and visiting with us and letting everybody know about the volunteer meet and match that's going to be taking place on April 26th at the Oak Park Public Library. We want everybody to take advantage of this, put it on your calendars. It's going to be a great event starting at 4:00 in the afternoon, and it will run until 8 p.m. There is parking available underneath of the library. And at 4:00 in the afternoon, you should be able to find neighborhood parking because it may overflow, which we're hoping happens. And so listen, thank you. We're excited. We'll be there representing the Doris Davenport Show with greatlocalshops.com. So come, you may be interviewed that day. We'd love to have you. So listen, thank you guys so much for coming in, and we will be right back with Morris Reed, CEO of Westside Health Authority. And welcome back to the Doris Davenport Show with Doug Wyman. We are having entirely too much fun. You have your bullets?
Yes.
We're going to stay with bullets. Let's see, I think I can. Yes, so get ready, because here I come, and here I am. So we are so excited. For this next guest, we're not going to waste any time because we have already eaten into his time. And I want to make sure that he has ample time to talk about the wonderful things that he is doing. Just one moment here. What I'd like to do first is introduce you to our next guest. Mr. Morris Reed Esquire is the president and CEO of the Westside Health Authority. It's a community-based organization which seeks to empower and build the capacity of neighborhood residents in order to improve health and economic wellness. Morris is the son of Jacqueline Reed, founder and former president and CEO of the Westside Health Authority. He was selected by the board of directors to assume the mantle of leadership following her retirement in 2011. Morris grew up on the west side of Chicago, where he became a licensed attorney, obtaining a Juris Doctorate degree from DePaul University College of Law and a Bachelor of Science degree from Marquette University in Business Administration. Prior to becoming CEO, Morris served the organization in many capacities, as you can imagine, since his mother did start the organization. Morris began his service with the organization as a youth organizer, establishing Youth Enterprises, a group of youth organized to deter young people from gangs by leveraging employment opportunities through relationships established in the community and local businesses. He also served as project manager of the Austin Wellness Center. The Austin Wellness Center is a 28,500 square foot health facility. When built in 2004, the Austin Wellness Center was the first new construction that was not a church or school in the Austin community. That's a conversation point we'll have to hit tonight. Under Morris's leadership as project manager, 75% of the construction contracts were provided to African American contractors from the community, providing over $4 million in contracts and creating over 25 jobs for community residents. I believe you have beat out the city of Chicago and the state of Illinois. Hello, I'm just saying. Before becoming CEO, Morris served as chair for the Coalition for Community Banking, a coalition of community organizations, churches, and residents to address the lack of investment by bailed out banks regarding insufficient lending, foreclosures, and abandoned properties within low-income communities. In this role, Morris has negotiated over $2 million in support to restore blighted properties and to provide foreclosure counseling and financial assistance to community residents and local businesses. Morris Reed, welcome to the Doris Davenport Show in the WPNA studios.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
You didn't know when you were coming to have so much fun, did you?
Hey, bringing some energy. It's a nice day outside, so hey. I like it, the fun.
Yeah.
It's time for fun, it's spring.
It is, right? The springtime. We want to make sure that people know. One thing I love about springtime is because it's the time when things start to bloom. So all the work that got done over the winter months, we start to see some of that take fruition now. People are coming outside and they're really ready to get busy. And one thing I have to say that you are is busy.
Right.
Now tell us first, before we get into the first meaty topic, let's talk a little bit about your involvement growing up at the Westside Health Authority with your mother as the leader.
Well, it was definitely interesting, to say the least. Mm-hmm. My mother has always been an activist. She was very inspired by the, involved in the civil rights era when young people really took the leadership role
mm-hmm.
in creating a movement to make their communities better, to make a social change in this country that was definitely needed. That was, they saw their parents being discriminated against. They saw their parents in a situation that, we couldn't tolerate anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And she saw the leadership grow, and she saw that people, normal, everyday people, are the answer to, you know, real problems in this country. And she wanted to be a part of the solution and not just continue accepting what society gave her. And so from that, just seeing her help people, she's always had a passion for people. Even when my own, to my own jealous nature, sometimes when I was a kid and I would see her with so many other kids and families, she started off as a social worker, an adoption worker. She was actually worked for Lutheran Children and Family Services,
yeah.
And she was the adoption worker of the year several times. And she just poured so much of herself into these kids who needed her. And at the time, I didn't understand it. I was like,
she
would buy
them
McDonald's, and I was the empty McDonald's in her car. And I was like, yo, where's mine? Why do I have to eat green beans and rice and peas? And she was like, you are so blessed you don't even know it. But you know, a 10-year-old doesn't understand it at the time. And so I had to grow into the work. And as I grew into the work, and I'm CEO now, it's just, I look back and I'm like, shame on myself.
Yeah.
For even questioning her love for me and love for, you know, the situation. So I really do appreciate her. It was something that when she wanted to retire, I was it really meant a lot to me that her legacy was continued
mm-hmm.
on the West Side. And I could never fill her shoes, but I wanted to make sure that the place existed and had the culture of making sure that we to bring people in who want to help people,
yes.
and had a passion for people. So,
yeah.
Yeah, it was very interesting growing up, to say the least.
Well, that's important. And I know I'm just so impressed by not only the work that the foundation that she laid with this organization, but just how it's evolved. And it's, I think, always difficult when you look at generational succession planning. There are different generations, you see things differently. But there really is a seamless sense of leadership there. You have, I think, your mother's vision in the sense that you both want what's right for the community of Austin. You want to see critical change take place, not just change. And as a young black man, having grown up, I think, watching your mother help so many other young black children, and you have children of your own.
Yes.
What is that like for you to see so many young black children, and it seems like there are far more today than ever before, going astray, and not just going astray. I mean, knowing that your mom was trying to keep kids out of gangs, that seems to be a real option for kids today.
It's disheartening. You know, one of the things that kind of stuck with me that she always mentioned was that the family you grow up in, that supportive network, does a lot to make who you are, who you eventually become as an adult. And all of us aren't lucky enough to grow up in a household that really supports us, that really cares for us. And a lot of children today don't have that household for a lot of different reasons. But then it also goes into your community.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of people could live in a nice community that even though your household doesn't give you everything that you need,
mm-hmm.
your community can then step in and pour into you to help you grow into something very successful and not go astray. And so it's one of the things that she said, that you may not have a supportive family, but you can't have a supportive community.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what WHA tries so hard to do, is make the communities around a lot of these young kids to be more supportive of them, to have
a relationship with them,
to be more engaged, and to support them as they grow and mature, and help them not go astray. And if they do go astray, let's give them another chance to bring them back into the fold so they could develop and be assets. And when they grow up, when they come back and contribute right back to the community that they grew up in. Have a good story to say. Say, listen, man, I love my hood. I love my neighborhood. My neighborhood is what made me who I am.
Right.
And who they are should be somebody great, should be somebody important. Somebody that we all can talk about and be proud of.
Well, you know, Morris, on that note, your organization has started something called the Good Neighbor Campaign. And I can see your heart in everything that you talk about. I have to admit that when I first met with you, I was expecting to hear a lot about health, Westside Health Authority. So I was really surprised to find out just how engaged you are in quote-unquote community development, let alone what we'll talk about next, economic development. But how does this Good Neighbor Campaign impact or increase public safety in the neighborhood?
The Good Neighbor Campaign is what it is. It's something that we talked about, that it takes a village to raise a child.
Mm-hmm.
So what does it take to raise this village
mm-hmm.
that can help the children? And so
mm-hmm.
when we do our outreach, we go door-to-door knocking, we meet so many good people
mm-hmm.
who just have a wall up for whatever reason. That they say, I'm a good person, and I would like to help, but I'm not gonna be engaged with what's going on. I'm not gonna, you know, I haven't known my neighbors. I've lived in this neighborhood for 20 years. I just go to my job, mm-hmm. and I come home, mm-hmm. and I have my own little network, but they're not engaged in what's going on in the neighborhood. But we need those good people to connect with other good people,
yeah.
and build relationships with each other, and build relationships with us,
mm-hmm.
churches, other volunteer mm-hmm. groups who have so many wonderful things going on, that only if we connected with each other.
Mm-hmm.
When we identify a kid on our block, I may not know how to help him, but now I'm engaged with another good neighbor, or a good organization, or a good Oak Park community,
mm-hmm.
who can help me find something for this kid,
mm-hmm.
to get him back on the straight and narrow.
Right.
And so even with Oak Park, you know, we're in Oak Park, and I have to really give people from Oak Park a lot of credit,
mm-hmm.
that when they heard about this campaign, they immediately said, what can we do?
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that we've done with a lot of Oak Park residents is to say, well, our kids need something to do, and they need to earn some money.
Mm-hmm.
So we connected with a few residents that offered to hire our kids to clean their garages,
mm-hmm.
to rake their leaves, to shovel snow. We didn't have much of a winter this year, thank God, but that snow could have really provided a lot of opportunity for our kids to go over and shovel snow.
Mm-hmm.
And our kids, they get something from that. They get mm-hmm. a sense of purpose. They get a sense of pride. And then they are connected back into the neighborhood. And then they see themselves as a good neighbor, and not just a burden or a menace to the other neighbors in the community. So it gives them a really sense of hope and a really sense of connection. And so now we have a good neighbor campaign where we have over 850 people
mm-hmm.
who have signed up to say they want to be involved.
Wow.
And so it's been really fantastic. And they have a huge week planned this upcoming week for spring break, since the
mm-hmm.
kids are out.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And I think given that we had such a light winter with not so many job opportunities, maybe one of the things that you can do is to tap into, and you were one of the lead community development, community partners for the Warner Film Festival in Austin this year, and I have to say your organization did a phenomenal job. Those young people that came through, they were so respectful. They were just so wonderful. They volunteered. So I have witnessed what they're capable of.
Right.
They understood a sense of time. They took value in the task ahead of them. It was just phenomenal. But one thing you might want to do is to tap into that green network. We have a number of churches that have community gardens that would love to hire perhaps a young person to help with planting and digging. And you know, there's a lot of life lessons learned in the garden. And we're going to be talking about some of the one of the other projects that you're interested in, but I can certainly help to put you in touch with some of the people who run the community gardens here in Oak Park. Two of the people that I am putting together with your partner, Yemisi,
mm-hmm.
is Ken Dunn, who was also a producer of one of the films that we showed in the screening. He's in Chicago to help with your solar farm. And also Gary Kunin, who is the CEO of Seven Generations Ahead, and he wrote the sustainability program for Oak Park and also for River Forest. And is the person responsible for a lot of the farm-to-table activity. He is the person who is behind what is about to come, which is solar in the community. And I want you to, there's so much synergy there. I've told him about you, I've told you about him, and you guys actually met. He co-facilitated with me at the Loretto Auditorium screening that you spoke at.
Okay.
That's okay, we'll get something more formal together, because the two of you definitely need to talk. But when you talk about this Good Neighbor campaign, how does this campaign help? You said how many people, 800 or?
We have 850 people who signed up.
So that is such an opportunity. What are you doing to get these people civically engaged? Is there a civic component to this?
There is a civic component. We have monthly meetings.
Mm-hmm.
Where the citizens, the residents who are a part of it, come up with things that they would like to have addressed with our local elected officials.
Mm-hmm.
And so to be a good neighbor, you have to be able to understand how do you engage your alderman? How do you engage your representative? How do you engage your congressman over issues that affect you? And so we train them in that aspect, as far as, it's not like a detailed training,
mm-hmm.
But what we do is we ask the aldermen and the other elected officials to come out,
mm-hmm.
to provide that information, give up their, you know, give their numbers, give up their contact information,
mm-hmm.
and say this is what they're currently working on, and have a dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
a lot of times, you know, in our communities, we see elected officials as this power figure, intimidating.
Yes. Yes.
Like, I'm just a bus driver, whoever I am. I don't feel like they're really going to listen to me.
Right.
But if the alderman then knows, I'm part of the Good Neighbor Campaign, uh-huh. Alderman, you better listen to me. They feel more empowered. They feel mm-hmm. more engaged to go to the alderman or go to their state rep or congressman and say, this is what we're looking at. This is what we need to have done. And so that part of it, giving them that voice, really you know, goes a long way.
Wow. I'm going to take a tangent here for a moment. Dino Andrews is a newly elected Oak Park Village Board trustee member. Consider this a formal invitation. I'm going to ask the board if there are trustees on the board who will be willing to do exactly that here in Oak Park with our young people. I'd like to host that, which is, it could be a monthly meeting where the young people have an opportunity to have a meeting with board members. We Facebook Live it, because that's what the young people like to do, so we do it their way. But they get to address their village board, because this is their village too.
I totally agree. I think that level of interaction and engagement mm-hmm. and transparency is something that officials need to be doing moving
yeah.
forward, and it's something I vowed to do from day one, is to be
mm-hmm.
the most accessible, you know, trustee, and I hope that I can lead the way in getting other trustees to be that accessible.
Well, I'm going to write it up and submit it, and I think it's something that probably could fit under the umbrella of the iGov, because that is the collaborative umbrella where the different taxing bodies come together, and the youth might just be the group that starts to, you know, publicly engage this group as a whole. But Morris, I want to talk about economic development.
Okay.
You have embarked on such a huge project. I mean, it's just phenomenal. I so applaud your efforts. Chicago Avenue is a huge corridor. River Forest is looking at developing their end of Chicago Avenue. Community members are pressing the board to look at Chicago Avenue. You have made the decision. You've done more than make the decision. You are actively engaged in developing the Chicago Avenue corridor. Tell us what your vision is, and also, what is a special service area designation?
Sure. Ever since we developed the Austin Wildlife Center back in 2004, we saw Chicago Avenue as a huge gateway to the Austin community.
Mm-hmm.
And starting in Cicero and ending at Austin Avenue, which then leads into Oak Park and River Forest area, was a unique gateway through Austin that a lot of travelers and a lot of commuters took every day, but they didn't realize they were in Austin. By the time they realized they left Oak Park, they were in Humboldt Park.
Mm.
And members of the community, and working with the Austin Chamber of Commerce, as well as a group that's been on Chicago Avenue for many, many, many years, is the African American Business Network, AAA BNA.
Mm-hmm.
And they were developing an entertainment and music district for businesses on the west end of Chicago Avenue. And they developed it, and they now have an identity, and they're called the Soul City Corridor.
Right.
And we wanted to really complement with the work that they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of times people see that only one thing can happen in a neighborhood at a time, but I think you need to build on other people's energy.
Mm-hmm.
If someone's starting to do something, you just don't sit back and say, oh, look what they're doing. You say, how can we get involved? How can we continue to build off of their work and develop the entire corridor of Chicago Avenue to be, have improvements, to really look at more, be a more of attractive space, to really offer opportunities for innovative ideas like the solar farm and other creative projects. And so we met with the alderman, and the alderman said the city has a special program now called these SSAs, and you may have seen them all over the city of Chicago. And they are basically ways for these community areas to identify a retail zone to really provide more investment, to really provide cultural expressions throughout, and to really give the community some identification markers. And so we applied for SSA, which is a special service area designation, and we will be the agents for it. We apply. We had a public hearing, and the property owners who own property within that corridor approve the designation. And this is not without cost. And so at first, when we first applied, a lot of people said, no, no way. The people who own property in that corridor would not be, are not willing to subject themselves to an additional tax because they just feel like the area is depressed and no one really wants to invest more money. It feels like it's a money pit right now. But when we talked to property owners, again, people were more bullish than bearish on the opportunities that could exist in Austin. They wanted to do something. They wanted to give back. They wanted to contribute. They wanted to be a partner with the city of Chicago. A lot of times people just think, oh, we want grants and aid. When we do need the grants and public money. But we wanted to show, like, listen, people who live here also want to be a partner. Mm-hmm. And so we wanted to buy in, and we did that by offering the additional tax. And it's a 1% tax that will be imposed against property owners on that strip. But that money will be solely controlled by the property owners within that area to reinvest.
Now, is this a TIF?
It is in a TIF area. However, this tax
is a special services area.
Yes, yeah, so the TIF is different from SSF.
Okay.
So the TIF goes to the city, which the mayor controls, which we would have to go to the mayor and say, yes. Oh, Mr. Mayor, we would like to use the TIF for these public projects. And it's like a yes or no situation.
Yes.
But with this SSA, the money goes back to the community.
Yeah, and it's like the mental health districts that I'm working on.
Exactly.
Same concept, I understand.
And so the
now let me ask
the
you
property owners get to decide what happens with that money.
That's awesome. And we're going to have to continue this conversation. I want to say now that we have such meaty conversations on the program that we always end up going over the time, which is why it's so wonderful to have great local shops here. Because when we sign off on the radio, we won't sign off on this portion of the interview. We'll be able to continue it on www.greatlocalshops.com. So I'm going to alert people now. You'll have about 7 minutes to make that transition. So if you're listening to the radio or your audio streaming on radiowpna.com, head on over to www, that beautiful online mall that I love to talk about. Not only will you see, you'll be enticed by clicking the Los Angeles tab. You may be enticed by clicking the New Orleans ad or the Washington, D.C. I ask you to bypass those. Click Chicago. Scroll down to the Doris Davenport Show. You'll see us live there. We will take this interview onto the Internet TV and complete it there. We give a special thanks to www.greatlocalshops.com. So now, as we're talking about with Morris Reed, the CEO of Westside Health Authority, the development that's taking place under the umbrellaship of Westside Health Authority on the Chicago Avenue business corridor, he was just explaining to us that what's making this possible is the Special Service Area designation, otherwise known as SSA. And I want to talk a little bit about that because I know that you mentioned the AAAB, NA, and how they started this Soul City Corridor, which has been just such a phenomenal project for so long. And we also know that even though, because we have this conversation here in Oak Park, North Avenue and Chicago Avenue are TIF districts. And we know that we had Kathy Aducey, the president of the River Forest Village Board, on the program, and she was talking about the TIF that they have for the development of, or that they may be starting for North Avenue in Chicago. And I know that part of the issues with TIF is that you have to have commercial properties that are actually paying property taxes in order to build the TIF. And so I don't know if that was the origin of the SSA, but I also know that today I was at the funeral for the son of Congressman Danny Davis, God rest his soul, Stacy. And one of the things you can't help but notice when you go down that corridor is that not just on every corner, it seems, but almost every three doors there's a church. And there are churches up and down that corridor. And I understand that the churches have formed an alliance. And I was just told that today, and I said, wow, we're talking about this today. But what is that like when you're trying to develop an economic development corridor, you're in touch with the community. Where, how do you collaborate? How do you work with the churches that are there? Are the churches, are the members of the churches also members of the community? Are they coming in from outside? How do these two groups, if they're both legitimate community members, work together?
Well, there's two types of churches. There's the churches that own property on Chicago Avenue, and then there's the churches that rent property. The churches that rent property are usually not as engaged as the churches that do own property. And the churches that own property are a very important part to what we're trying to do, not only as property owners, but we see them as partners that are self-sufficient, they have cash flow, they have a lot of investment, they have congregational members. And when we speak to them, they also want to see how the church can play a role in bringing new businesses. All of the property that they own that's not being used solely for the church could be used for a business opportunity. If the church wanted to start a for-profit business or if they wanted to develop space to attract one of their members who may be an entrepreneur who wants to start a new business. And that's kind of what we want. We want to try to bring in these new entrepreneurs, offer the space at reasonable lease rates or even at free lease. And then with the new opportunities with the TIF, as well as other public subsidies available, it's a unique opportunity for people right now to move into businesses on that Chicago Avenue, because they could get up to 25% of any of their improvements or build out paid for by the city. And so 25%. A lot of them don't know that, man. We want to basically capture that funding while it's available now.
Sure.
Because if you don't use your TIF money, and if you don't use these grant money, they'll take it away and say, you know what, we did offer it, and then who fought with it? You know, they'll start pointing fingers and say, you know what, the community didn't want to do anything. I tried to partner with them. So we have the opportunity, let's strike and take advantage of it. And the church can help us identify who those new businesses are. You know, that's a lot of power that church, and it's not being used. So let's use that power. Let's not discard it or isolate ourselves from the church. We need to work together.
So is that collaboration happening? Is it just resistance at this point because it's new, or have there actually been conversations where there is collaboration?
There is collaboration.
Good.
We've been working with the church and trying to help them understand the process. They're open. They're part of our meetings. They're part of the Good Neighbor campaign.
Yes.
They also want to see change, and so we're working towards that goal.
Great.
Hopefully, once they start to see the new changes and the newer things come, it would also inspire them. And, you know, it's difficult to say we need to give a church hope and give them faith, but only if the church has had a little faith.
Right. Well, you know, the thing that I would add, and Dino, I know you want to jump in here, is that back in the day, and your mom can attest to this, well, although I don't know if she's even old enough, but, you know, a lot businesses in the Black community used to start in the churches. I mean, it was in the church basements, that insurance companies, that all kinds of businesses began right in the basement of churches. When we talk about what we know today as business development centers, those business development centers were all housed in the church.
Right.
So there are many things that the churches can do. And when I see this, anything that sounds like a loggerhead between economic development versus the churches, I say, wait a minute now.
Right.
We cannot have this impeding progress. Because the last time I checked, the Bible said that he would have for us a life that is exceeding and abundant.
Amen.
And so I don't want to start preaching today, although I am licensed to do so. Dino, you wanted to jump in here?
Sure. Mars, what do you see as a couple of your biggest challenges moving forward? I mean, there's all this great stuff going on Chicago Avenue, and all sorts of progress doesn't come without pushback and challenges. What do you see as those challenges?
Our biggest challenges are just the fear and the discernment over public safety. One of the things that we know we have to improve on is to improve the safety, improve the look of safety. Right now, unfortunately, Austin, there is a gateway for drug trafficking. We know that along Chicago Avenue, there's a few stops where a lot of suburban people come to buy their drugs. And we need to change that, and it's something that we work with, not only with the law enforcement, but the elected officials on even drug treatment centers and mental health facilities.
Because this is an addiction problem that's really something that we have to address before we just lock everyone up. Because locking up everyone does not solve the problem. You lock someone up today, that family is impacted, but then there's someone out there again tomorrow. Those opportunities, as long as they exist, there's always going to be somebody there. So it has to be a comprehensive approach. And so this Good Neighbor campaign, we are flooding that area around Chicago Avenue to engage all those families, to engage all the people who live over there, who hang out over there, to figure out what's going on, to have a relationship with them. And if we have a relationship, we understand that problem a little bit more closely, and we would know how to address it. But you just can't say, just lock everybody up, because that hasn't worked.
Right, I totally agree. And when you speak of being a good neighbor, I've been an outspoken advocate of Oak Parkers shopping in Austin, building bridges. How can Oak Park be a good neighbor, whether it be from a municipal standpoint or a commercial standpoint? What are ways that you see Oak Parkers as being able to be a good neighbor to the Austin community?
It's just that. I mean, we have to tear down that imaginary wall. You know, it just seems like Austin Avenue, there's this imaginary wall where a lot of people just don't want to cross. You know, and it's this fear in the Austin neighborhood. It used to be for a while that, Oak Park is going to take over Austin. And I don't know where that comes from, but I found Oak Park people don't want Austin to bleed over into Oak Park, going to high school in Oak Park. So we have to tear down imaginary wall. We have to figure out, just as you say, shop in Austin if you can, be more engaged into Austin activities. We plan on doing a lot of different things with this SSA the next following summer, because now we're just getting started. And as we have activities and festivals and farming opportunities, come check out our new urban farms. Come to some of our activities.
And where can we learn about these? Because one of my biggest challenges is getting the word out. That's always the hardest thing to do is promoting. And, you know, I know that the Austin Chamber of Commerce had a website. I don't think it's been updated in many years. Are there other websites that we can go to, or other places to go to get information about things that are going on in Austin in real time?
You know, I would say we are weak at that point. And we probably could use some help, some volunteers to help with our marketing and our advertising. But I think some of our local papers do a pretty good job, and maybe that's something we could bring up with the Wednesday Journal, some of your information publications, and the Doris Davenport Show, things like that.
I was just about to say, one of the things that we would like to do as well is in real time, at least once a week, to have that kind of community corner where we announce those things that are taking place, and it should be where we have a young person come in and let that be their thing that they do. Where they're going around to the different organizations and keeping a tally of what's happening, so that each week it's refreshed and updated. And as we get the website together, we'll be able to have that Austin Corner on there as well.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that'd be great. And I'd certainly invite you, you know, if there's posters and stuff. We have the Austin newspapers at Felony Frank's restaurant up on North Avenue. Any community announcements, we've got a bulletin board there. I'd invite you to bring anything over there that you need promoted.
Well, I certainly would take advantage of that.
And I'm going to say something a little unorthodox here. You just talked about the element of crime as it relates to drugs. And we know that clearly we saw a lot of people locked up in the 90s. We saw a lot of people locked up in the 70s, whether it was from crack cocaine. These were mostly blacks and browns. That used the drug, were addicted to the drug, that sold the drug, and they were all locked up. It didn't matter what level they were on. Now that we've seen methamphetamine and heroin rise to the degree that it has risen, this drug situation has now poured into the white suburban areas. Right. And so what we find are a lot of families being disrupted because the kids are becoming more addicted to these very addictive drugs. And they have begun to decriminalize the drugs. And not only are they decriminalizing the drugs, but the people who are selling the drugs are still caught up in drug, quote unquote, warfare. And as we also see a parallel economic development community beginning to legalize some of these drugs. On the one side, we see the medical marijuana groups forming, and we also see the heroin group groups where part of the treatment is not to, because it's an addictive drug where you can't just say, I'm going to quit. So there are centers set up where people can continue because they're functioning citizens and it becomes less criminalized. Why not put some of these groups together and look at a conversation between municipalities and the law enforcement where we actually talk about partnering some of these legitimate organizations with the illegitimate organizations so everybody becomes legitimate. Now clearly there are going to be some people that are not, what's the word, that are not going to be able to cross over as easily as others, but there are many that can. But we need to make sure that we have opportunities for everybody and not have that opportunity be stymied because we're not ready to have those kinds of conversations. Yeah. So now there's something else. We hear a lot about transforming people. We hear a lot about transforming environments. But we don't really hear a lot about transforming physical spaces. Now some people, you included, use the word reinventing. What are your thoughts about reinventing the physical space? I'm really excited about this one.
Well, you know, one of my pet peeves is that I hate seeing vacant lots and vacant storefronts and vacant and blighted areas. I think those are real opportunities for creative people to do something very inspiring with that space. A lot of the outreach, and you know, we do a lot of outreach. Some of the outreach when we start working with some of the property owners on commercial, in this commercial corridor, they were very creative and just need a little help. And one guy was Omar, and he was very interesting to me. He owns a vacant lot on Chicago Avenue, and he went out. He just wanted to do something, so he spent $3,000 of his own money to buy a greenhouse. Mm-hmm. But he said he had no idea how to install it. Basically, he said he bought it online, and a truck comes pulling up to his house. Everything's in about a million parts, and they just dump it in front of his house. Say, here you go, sign here. He said, I have no idea how to install this greenhouse, but this is something that I wanted to do. I wanted to bring farming to Chicago Avenue so we can do more farm-to-table ideas. And so when we got together, we said, well, absolutely. In the past, we worked with a lot of seniors who have all of these cultural recipes from Mississippi and Arkansas and Tennessee and really dealing with fresh greens and beans. And and so it's just that, you know what, we can have a day where we can grow our own food within our neighborhood and have these recipes talk to our younger people and really have this organic project where we can farm the food, you know, create the food through our farm and then cook it right there within a facility that's vacant next door and offer the food for sale where you're having fresh greens, fresh kale, fresh peas, you know, sweet potatoes and different things cooked
by. And imagine
by
the health impact.
The health impact, that. Yes, absolutely. It would be one of those healthy things that you enjoy doing,
right.
You know, and so that's something that we're working on, and hopefully that would be, inspire other people to do something with their space. And so that's what we're looking into with the SSA as well. Just work with property owners who own that building, mm-hmm. but it's been vacant and blighted for years, and they're just holding on to it for whatever reason. But inspire them to do something with it and not just let it sit there.
Yeah, this is great. And it was one of the things one of the reasons I got so excited about the One Earth Film Festival and bringing together the community partners, because
right.
so many people in Austin are interested in community gardening. And what Omar wants to do is just phenomenal. I mean, when I heard the whole vision laid out where it'll start with, you know, growing things and really build into a farm, and the really the biggest part of this, you guys haven't even heard the biggest part of it. This farm, it's going to be energized by solar energy. So this is, I cannot wait for you and Gary to sit down and talk. This is just going to be absolutely phenomenal. Yemisi, I know you're listening, and you and Gary are going to be sitting down and having this conversation very soon. And Omar, if you're out there on the road, I hope you've got us tuned in, because we are just so proud of what all of you are doing in this space. It is really amazing. And getting back to the economic development, You also have an interest in developing retail that's more culturally inspired. What does that look like?
Well, we just want to really offer retail opportunities to artists, to more hip, cool type of things that, you know, that you can find maybe in Bronzeville, or you, if you go into West Humboldt Park or Pilsen, you will see cultural retail. You'll see retail that has a cultural spin on it. And so that's some of the things that we want to encourage some of the, our people to do, and even provide opportunities for them to do it, whether it be just hiring local artists to deck out their space, to do the decor of their space, or a restaurateur or one of the entrepreneurs who comes with more of a hip cultural name to identify their business with.
Sure. Oh, I've got somebody else for you to meet too then.
We have one retail business coming. They're coming. It's Brown Sugar Bakery. They're a staple on the south side. They have, I think, in Navy Pier. So we're very excited to welcome them into the neighborhood, to bring their style of cupcakes, which is different than, you know, cupcakes you may see at Molly Cupcakes or some of the other big cupcake places.
Well, see, but that's an opportunity for collaboration, too, because we might be able to introduce Brown Sugar Cupcakes to Live Cafe, to Serenity, to other places that can sell their cupcakes because they're unique. And that's the kind of cross-trade that we need to see more of.
Right.
It doesn't have to just be limited to attending each other's events and coming to help each other out from an employment aspect, but when you start really trading with one another, that's when you know you're really talking about the cross cultures, bridging those imaginary walls. So now, who are some of your other community partners?
Well, I just mentioned them earlier. As far as the economic development side, we are working very closely with the Austin Chamber of Commerce.
Mm-hmm.
We are working with AAA B&A. We are working with Hope Church, Pastor Steve Epting.
Yes, he's one of our favorites.
Absolutely. And we're working with some of our banks that are in the neighborhood. U.S. Bank, we're getting them more involved to provide resources to improve the housing stock around the Chicago Avenue corridor. We know we need a strong housing market to really support a retail environment. So U.S. Bank has been really helpful in helping people understanding financial literacy, how to obtain mortgages. And they worked with us to look at acquiring some of the vacant properties that exist around there so we can secure those, which we think will help support the safety initiatives on Chicago Avenue as well. And then the residents themselves, like I said, we feel like the people are the authority on improving health and wellness in the neighborhood. And so we really work a lot with engaging people to run the corridor.
Is there a conflict between this kind of economic development and what made me think of this statement about the U.S. Bank helping to strengthen the housing market? And, you know, one of the things we've been talking about on the show lately, and in fact, we just secured an interview with Tony Preckwinkle coming up soon, is the tax sale that just begun. Not only did the tax sale just start, but I was also talking with State Representative Camille Lilly a few days ago about some of the bills that they were passing in Springfield to give seniors a break, give not just seniors and veterans, but people who simply have been, you know, negatively impacted by the economic downturn that so many people experienced, and they've had a hard time trying to get back on their feet. And now in the economy, it's just not easy for people today. So they're really trying to do things to add a buffer. Is there a conflict between people who are on the verge of losing their homes and speculators, if you will? And I don't want to put U.S. Bank in the speculator camp unless they belong there.
U.S. Bank, you know, was part of the problem, and that's one of the groups that we were advocating that they do more in communities of color to repair and to restore the market into the housing stock. But there's a huge conflict. I mean, our community cannot afford to lose any more homeowners.
Right.
I think before the economic downturn, we were at about 50% home ownership, 58%, but now we're down to 30% home ownership. So only 30% of the people who live in Austin actually own their property, which is a huge problem. And it caused thousands and thousands of vacant properties that, like you said, speculators pick up. Mm-hmm. They put whomever or any, you know, sometimes no one in these homes, and they just become homes for squatters and crime, and it really discourages the other residents who pay their taxes, who pay their mortgages on their block. Mm-hmm. And we want to make sure that we keep those responsible mm-hmm. homeowners there and not discourage them to sell and pick up and leave. And so it's a huge conflict. And that's why we're involved, because we're not speculators, we're investors. Mm-hmm. And so where before a speculator were to pick up a property for pretty much nothing, we would buy the home or acquire the home as the REO from a lender, mm-hmm. and we would find a family to live in at home, mm-hmm. and we would restore that home. We would use community people to actually preserve the home and do the repairs. Everything that we do, we try to 100% mm-hmm. offer those opportunities to local contractors for economic opportunities.
And how widespread is that gate? I mean, I can imagine that there are people, once that announcement was made, that they either themselves or have people that do nothing but sit there and study the tax rolls to see when somebody's taxes are due so that they can, you know, jump on that opportunity. So how strong is that gate, if you will, that can kind of, you know, it's a protection that people need. And I'm just not sure that there is a group, and maybe there is, and maybe it's yours, but a group that is really on top of it enough where people really do have that protection. I mean, because unless a home goes up for sale, how do you really know?
It's a huge problem, and there's not much resources out there for it. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, the notice kind of came out late. This was something that we probably should have been working on for the past 3 months. Mm-hmm. You know, I applaud our elected officials for coming out and having a press conference for it, but it was within weeks of the tax sale.
Exactly.
You know, next time, I think, hopefully there won't be a next time, but I think some of these things we have to get ahead of, months ahead, mm-hmm. so we can do proper planning and protect people who may have issues with losing their property and find out what resources are available. But
yeah, well, that's good. I'm glad to see that once we knew, at least we know that the Westside Health Authority did the right thing and was there to, and continues to be there to help people. Now tell me about this, some of the cultural projects that are going to be, that are being envisioned for this business corridor along Chicago Avenue.
So we have a unique opportunity coming up, and I hope our neighbors in Oak Park can also help support this. On July 18th, which is Nelson Mandela's birthday, we are honoring him and Dr. King with the creation of a Justice and Peace Plaza, and it will be on the corner of Cicero and Chicago Avenue. In 2014, State Rep. LaShawn Ford was successful in designating Cicero as Mandela Road.
Mm-hmm.
And
kudos
so,
to LaShawn Ford, always on the case.
And so with this designation, again, we want to build off of that energy and momentum that the Rep. Did and say, you know what, we need to have a corner on Mandela Road that really will symbolize peace and justice and really honor his legacy and be able to have people visit and they can learn more about Nelson Mandela, not just visitors, but our children
mm-hmm.
who live in the neighborhood who may not know who Nelson Mandela is. And it would be something of pride for me and for them to say, look, this is a black man that is recognized around the world as a man of peace and a man who fought for justice, as well as Dr. King, two of our greatest African-American heroes in the world. So
this is July 18th?
So July 18th, we want to do an unveiling and a party.
And what would you like the business community and the nonprofit community, specifically of Oak Park and River Forest, to help with? What is it
to attend, but we still are raising funds for it, donations.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go to our website to donate to Westside Health Authority. That's www.healthauthority.org.
www.healthauthority.org.
You can also like us on Facebook, Westside Health Authority. But we're offering opportunities for people to donate. This is a project that's going to cost $60,000. We've raised about $20,000 so far. We're also offering people a unique opportunity to purchase a brick. To have a brick engraved that's going to surround the plaza, just showing people who are supportive of peace and justice and these two heroes. And so we hope that this will be a significant piece as you drive down mm-hmm. Chicago Avenue.
Yes.
you will see this statue lit up with plaques honoring Nelson Mandela off of Mandela Road, and then a plaque honoring Dr. King off of Chicago Avenue.
Wow, that's phenomenal.
With the chieftain statue uplifted on a pedestal.
So here's what I would like to do with the faith-based community that's, and I know Hope Community Church will be one of them, but that's already partnering with you. And that's to have the young people, and we can set an age range where they actually, and there's a young man I just met at your place, Dino, the spoken word, the two young men.
The impact makers.
The impact makers. They're going to be coming on the program, and I'd like to involve them in what I'm about to say. What I want to offer is I want to engage those two to work with, and we'll put something together where they have to apply, fill out an application, and we want them to do their homework, do the history research on both Nelson Mandela and Dr. King, and let's have a spoken word contest. And we can do an oral and spoken word, and so we'll put them through some training, and maybe we can get great local shops to engage as well, so that the final, at the end, once the winners are selected, they get to come on the radio and actually present their spoken word or their oral piece. They will hopefully be on internet TV if we can twist the arms of greatlocalshops.com for a good cause. And then maybe even depending on their age, there might be an opportunity for some kind of a summer internship at Felony Franks or one of the other organizations that Dino is participating in. And we can have the training taken place by our impact makers.
Awesome.
Yeah, and that this way maybe we can have, because I know you have a full program, but we would like to then give an
Not
opportunity.
Not yet, so they probably will have an opportunity to
be on the program.
To be on the program, absolutely.
One to do the Nelson Mandela piece and one to do the Dr. King piece.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and maybe we can, depending on what day, I'd have to check the schedule for the Chicago West Community Music Center, but they just might be able to put some music behind those two pieces of the performance. But something to talk about.
Absolutely. See, there you go. We have a project that we can work on.
That's right. And I also, you mentioned LaShawn Ford. I was going to mention this and forgot to do it during the show. We'll still have an opportunity to tee it up next week. But LaShawn is somebody that I have so much respect for. When he gets a hold of something, he doesn't let it go.
Right.
And he stays with it. And he's been on this path of doing everything that he can to combat the lack of resources for people on the west side of Chicago that are substance abusers of heroin particularly.
Mm-hmm.
And he formed what's called the West Side Heroin Task Force, which I'm a part of. And he has called for, it's a state of emergency. And actually it's the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention that reported that the opioid-related death rate in Illinois rose 120% from 2014 to 2015. Those are the most recent recorded numbers. It is, as LaShawn rightfully says, a state of emergency. And he is holding a town hall meeting on the 18th of April at Malcolm X College from 1 to 3:30. We need as many people at this town hall as possible. The speakers are going to be Congressman Danny K. Davis of the 7th District, Representative Mary Flowers of the 31st District, who is also the Assistant Majority Leader. Of course, Representative LaShawn Ford of the 8th District. And Nerva Shaw, who is always involved in State Rep Ford's projects. He's the Director of the Illinois Department of Public Health. And of course, the task force will be there. But it's April 18th from 1 to 3:30 at Malcolm X College. It's a town hall meeting on this state of emergency for the lack of resources on the west side of Chicago to help with this heroin epidemic. So listen, this has been phenomenal. What else would you like to tell us about the good work you're doing? And I also would love a commitment that you will keep us posted by coming back periodically.
Sure, absolutely. I mean, that, you know, our organization offers opportunities for a lot of people to do a lot of good work, and I couldn't say honestly that the Western Health Authority is what it is without those good people. So I just like to say to all the staff that's out there listening, to all our volunteers and residents, that I thank you. I appreciate you, and again, you guys are why Western Health Authority is what it is. And I would just like to tell everybody else who don't know about us, like us on Facebook, you'll get our instant updates on exactly what we're doing. Our website, you know, it has information on there, but if you want the current information, really our Facebook page has the most detailed current information. And again, that's Westside Health Authority.
Westside Health Authority, and that the website address is
www.healthauthority.org.
And the Facebook page is under Westside Health Authority.
Correct.
That is Morris Reed, the CEO and president of the Westside Health Authority. And I'd also like to follow the advice of my tech advisor, Dino Andrews, and ask you to head over to the Doris Davenport Show Facebook page and give us a like. We're going to be moving into this technology age as we grow. And we want to thank you so much for visiting with us and sharing all this great information with us. And I'd just like to end by saying, Jacqueline Reed, mother to Morris Reed, you done good. And on that note, we will see you all next week. Please tune in to www.greatglobalshops.com. And this is where you will find this interview archived. Good night.